Morning, everyone. I'm coming to you this morning from the balcony of the church. So we're getting close, I guess. And I want to welcome you to this Sunday service for the last day of January 2021. This is the fourth Sunday after the Epiphany. I want to invite you to join in on our virtual annual congregational meeting at 11 a.m. today in lieu of the coffee hour. Okay, so hope to see you there. I'm Bill Hackett. I'm a deacon at Greenhill People's Church. And I want to welcome you into our church today, and thank you for welcoming us into your home and your hearts. You know, at GPC, we celebrate an open communion. So I'm going to give you some time to join us in communion later, to get something to eat, whether a cookie, a toast, cracker, something to drink, coffee, tea, juice, whatever, as we celebrate our feast later. This morning, the delivery of our sermon will be from Reverend Doug, along with our benediction, which will be community celebrated by Kim Perret, our readings by Ellen Green, our prayers by Sherry Klein, and our music provided by Annie Oslo. Whether you're a member of GPC or any church, or no church at all, you're invited to join us in communion today. So whoever you are, wherever you are on your life, spiritual journey, welcome to worship at Greenhill People's Church. Now, let's center ourselves for worship as we listen to this morning's prelude by Yeti.
Good morning. My name is Ellen Green, and I'm doing the readings today. The first reading is from Deuteronomy. It's chapter 18, verses 15 through 20 from the Message. God, your God, is going to raise up a prophet for you. God will raise him up from among your kinsmen, a prophet like me. Listen obediently to him. This is what you've asked God, your God, for at Horeb, on the day you were all gathered at the mountain and said, "We can't hear any more from God, our God. We can't stand seeing any more fire. We'll die." And God said to me, "They're right. They've spoken the truth. I'll raise up for them a prophet like you from their kinsmen. I'll tell him what to say, and he'll pass on everything I command him. And anyone who won't listen to my words spoken by him, I will personally hold responsible. But any prophet who fakes it, who claims to speak in my name, something I haven't commanded him to say, or speaks in the name of other gods, that prophet must die."
For all my knees and rise. Sherry Klein, a longtime member of Greendale People's Church and a deacon of the church. I encourage people to share their joys and concerns. If you are watching on Facebook Live, you can enter them online in the chat. You can send an email to careministry@greendalepeopleschurch.org. You can also enter your prayer request on our homepage or call the church office and leave a message in the general voice church voice mailbox. Or go to our website, greendalepeopleschurch.org. I want to offer prayers for members in our congregation, community, and those facing challenging circumstances. I want to pray for those struggling with medical, behavioral, or physical issues, and those who are caring for them. For those who are struggling to put food on the table, in need of permanent housing, important medicinal help. For our children learning remotely as best they can, and the parents and the teachers who guide them. Let us pray for our community, our nation, as we start this new year with a new president. I want to pray for those who are suffering from illness, facing loss, those suffering from depression, struggling with addiction, for all those experiencing challenges who are hungry or feel lost and alone, for anyone suffering from the COVID, recovering from the COVID, or families that have lost their loved ones due to the COVID. We especially remember this day. Lord, we pray for those who have gone before us and those who live with you in paradise. And for those in our presence today, even remotely, for our families and our friends, and for those yet to come, we are asked for continued blessings and that you remain in our lives and in our hearts. We ask you this in the words you taught us so long ago. We know that you hear our prayers, whether spoken or unspoken, for you came to us in the one Jesus, who is the Christ. How should you taught us to pray and love and taught us this prayer that we now pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
The second reading is from Mark chapter 1, verses 21 through 28, and it's also from the Message. Then they arrived at Capernaum. When the Sabbath arrived, Jesus lost no time in getting to the meeting place. He spent the day there teaching. They are surprised at his teaching, so forthright, so confident, not quibbling and quoting like a religion scholars. Suddenly, when they're still in the meeting place, he was interrupted by a man who was deeply disturbed and yelling out, "What business do you have here with us, Jesus Nazarene? I know what you're up to. You're the Holy One of God, and you've come to destroy us." Jesus shut him up. "Quiet. Get out of him." The afflicting spirit threw the man into spasms, protesting loudly, and got out. Everyone there was incredulous, buzzing with the curiosity. "What's going on here? A new teaching that does what it says? He shuts up defiling demonic spirits and sends them packing?" News of this traveled fast and was soon all over Galilee.
And thank you for welcoming me to your home. I can assure you that you need not worry about the heating budget, at least what we're doing today, because it's quite chilly in here and it's invigorating, so let's get the show on the road. Ellen read a passage from the Gospel according to Mark, where we hear that Jesus came to Capernaum with authority. Authority not like the scribes had in Capernaum. And I want to talk about authority today. I want to talk in particular about how being an author gives one authority. Jesus comes to author a new story in Capernaum, and that's where his authority comes from. An author is creative. The scribes of Capernaum, on the other hand, handled other people's writings. They didn't write themselves. They were not authors. They simply handled a script. Scribe and script come from the same word. And script is usually the way things work in any religious setting. So Jesus comes to the synagogue, like coming to church, and he discovers that there in that church, like every church, there is a script that people are following. Even if it's not written down, people do the same things again and again, because that's just the way we do it in church. This past week, I asked some of the women of GPC a question I already knew the answer to. I said, now at GPC, do people come each Sunday and sit in the same pews week after week? And they chuckled and said, yes. And I said, well, welcome to the human race. Welcome to churchgoers everywhere, because basically church is following a script. We do the same things, sit in the same place, expect the same things, interact in the same ways, and wonder why nothing new ever happens among us. Well, when Jesus comes to Capernaum, he does not come to follow their script. He comes to write and author a new story, a new script. And it's pretty upsetting for some people. Shakespeare had said, all the world comes and goes on stage and plays their part and vanishes. Church is very much the same way. And if you ask them, well, who's the author of this script? They would say, you know, I really don't know. It's just the way we do things. Well, when Jesus comes, it is clear that he comes as an author, as a creator, to bring about a new story. And we're here today on our Sunday where we have our annual meeting as a church to talk about Jesus coming to write and author a new story. And when he does, there is authority. But people don't always accept that kind of going off script the way Jesus did. You know, 25 years ago or more, actually, when I first started out in ministry, I was kind of at a low church, kind of an informal kind of a congregation. And so on vacation during the summers, I would try to go to a different setting where I would experience sort of a different script, though I didn't have that terminology back in those days. So I would go to Episcopal churches. And the first time I went to an Episcopal church, I learned, if you're going to go to an Episcopal church, Doug, you want to sit in the front pew, not the back. Because if you sit in the front, you will be the first one to drink from that common cup. When you sit in the back pew, you're the last one. And that didn't agree with me. So next time I went to the front pew, only to discover that that wasn't the solution. Because there was nobody in front of me during that service who I could follow to go according to the script of that church. I didn't know when to stand up, when to sit down, when to kneel. I didn't know which book to take out of the rack to read from. I was lost. And I could tell there was something about me that was disorienting to all the people behind me. I was not going according to their script. I was kind of a misfit, a scallywag. Who is this guy and what is he doing here? Well, I know that when I preach, it's always enjoyable when someone says like, amen, shouts up. So there in that service, I thought, well, maybe this Episcopal priest would appreciate it. So after he said something, I said, yeah, that's good news. And I noticed everybody in that sanctuary looking down their noses at this person who was going off script. Stick to the script, they were saying with their eyes and with their expressions on their faces. There's rage when people go off script. We like things predictable, regular. Don't go off script. Well, ever since then, I'm sure Episcopalians everywhere are grateful that I no longer walk through the doors of their churches and upset their routines and their scripts, though I did find their services to be refreshing, going off script every once in a while. Well, Jesus does not come to Capernaum to fit into the script of the synagogue there in Capernaum. He comes into the synagogue to fit them into his script. He comes as an author to bring about a new story. Not like the scribes who simply handle the script, handle somebody else's writings. He comes in with authority, with authorship, and begins a new story. The rigmarole, the script, was normally the authority in the synagogue of those days. They weren't led by rabbis, those synagogues in first century Judea. Common people kind of cooperated together. And if there was an authority in the synagogue, it was the rigmarole, the script, the way they always do it. And so when Jesus came in, they just expected him to fit into the script. Don't disrupt our routine, until Jesus did. But they were delighted because he came as one with authority, not doing what everybody always does. Well, Jesus would go into synagogues throughout Judea as he traveled from town to town, and he would find himself opposed by a contrary authority, which was the status quo of that day. Kind of the taken for granted, implicit ways that things were done in each synagogue, uniquely, individually. The kind of thing where people came in and, well, everybody knows this is what we do. And Jesus would go off script, and people would get sometimes delighted, astonished. Wow, this is great. And at other times, people wanted to run him right out of town. You know, they don't want freedom. They don't want to live by spirit. They want to live according to what is certain, what is regular, what is comfortable, what they've always done before, so that they don't really have to think about what they're doing. They like predictability, sameness, relief from having to improvise, having to think, having to choose, having to live with the uncertainty that requires faith, not just in a worship service, but in all of life. Faith involves risk, and risk involves going off the script sometimes and trusting not the script, but God who is with us. Dostoevsky was a great novelist in Russia a couple centuries ago. He wrote a book called The Brothers Karamazov. And in that story, he writes a parable, a story about the Grand Inquisitor that took place during the Spanish Inquisition centuries ago. And in that Spanish town of Seville, there is someone who has entered, and it turns out it is Jesus who has come back to earth. And he is performing certain things that are irregular and out of the routine. Some miracles are taking place. And so the Grand Inquisitor, the one who is in charge of the Inquisition and holding everything under control, has Jesus arrested. And he visits Jesus in the jail cell and says, "What do you think you are doing? We are doing what is best for people. You are not. People do not want freedom. People do not want to live with uncertainty. People do not want to have to think for themselves. And we do all of that for them. You, on the other hand, overestimate human nature. You invite people into freedom, into living with faith rather than certainty. And people just can't handle that. You must go away and allow us to do what we are doing, because this is what people need. We care more for people than you do, they said in so many words, because people don't want freedom. People want the script. They don't want to live with freedom and by the Spirit. And so in that story, Jesus leaves Seville. And we don't know exactly what happens from there, but I would imagine it is just the same old thing. Nothing creative, no authorship, just a script that everybody follows day after day, the same old story. Not in the Gospels, maybe in Dostoevsky, but not in the Gospels. Jesus does not leave town without attempting at least to write a new script and inviting people into a new story. But people so often rejected, resisted. You know, one of the things that I think about, the image that I have in my mind of maybe what it was like there, was, have you ever seen those, typically it's more of a European thing. If you go to a place where they have kind of a mechanical scene, where they have machines who appear like people doing certain things in a town, could be a nativity scene, it could be an old Swiss town or whatever, where you'll have a character, a mechanical figure, who will look like a blacksmith pounding away at a horseshoe. There may be a man sawing wood, or one who appears like a man. There might be a seamstress sewing. Just a machine doing the same thing over and over again. A man sitting at a cow all day long. They only look like living beings, but they are machines. The Grand Inquisitor would say that's the way people would prefer to live. And Jesus says, no, I have not come to minister to machines, but to bring people to life. I can imagine in one of those towns a picture of a preacher and what appears to be a church doing this all day long, because isn't that what preachers do? And now I'm preaching in the sanctuary for the first time. And I'm wondering, you're looking at me and saying, is he on script? Is he doing it the way we do it here at GPC? I'm not wearing a robe. I don't have a stole. Am I off script? Will I face consternation as a result? Or is this an opportunity maybe to do new things? To bring about a new script, a spirit among us. People like machinery, but Jesus wants human beings coming alive. When I think about maybe the setting that might resonate with you as far as this goes, As a minister, I spend a lot of time in hospitals, visiting patients and so on, parishioners, and I've noticed something interesting about a hospital. A hospital is like a theater, you might say. It is certainly a stage. And all the people in there are playing their own particular role. The nurses are identifiable by their dress. The doctors are all wearing white coats. There's no mistaking who the doctors are. The janitors are all wearing the same uniform, often a green uniform. Building maintenance are wearing blue uniforms, usually with work boots. Security personnel are wearing their officer's uniform with a badge and a belt and so on. The cafeteria personnel have their hairnets, you know who they are. Office personnel are usually in plain clothes. The hospital administrators are wearing their suits. Gift shop volunteers are wearing their orange coats. And everybody is in their role and performing the script day after day. They may not even know that they are performing a script, but each one in every situation is going according to the same script. It keeps things regular, and that's not a bad thing in a hospital. It keeps things more certain. We know who each other is. But one thing's for sure, don't leave your role. Don't leave your part. Don't deviate from the script. Because in the hospital, the script has the authority. This is how it works. Don't mess with the script. Stay in your role. Keep the hospital stage production predictable. We need that. If you want to keep your job. Because that's one of the ways that we're kept in line. You don't want to be written out of the play, so people go along and sometimes forfeit their freedom. You know, in first century Capernaum, maybe the worst thing that could have happened to a person was to be expelled from the synagogue and from the community. You might say, written out of the play. What do they do each day? They're no longer a participant on the script. They're no longer in the play. It was a fate worse than death for many people. The strictest day of all was the Sabbath. These are the things you will do. These are the things you will not do. You will only do a certain Sabbath. And if you deviate from the script, there's problems. And Jesus didn't go according to the script. He healed people on the Sabbath day, and boy, did that wrangle and get into their craw. They wanted to say to Jesus, stick to the script. Let the script have authority. This is the way we want it. Regular, same old, same old. We don't need new. We want predictable. I remember when I used to read bedtime stories to my children. I have 3 children. Now I have 6 grandchildren and still read bedtime stories. And they loved it because I would read usually the same story to them night after night. But there would be some nights when I just wanted to get it over with. You know, I was tired. I wanted to go to bed myself. And so I try to kind of skip a couple of pages to get to the end as quickly as possible. And I want to let you know that each and every one of those children knew exactly what I was doing and said, hey, you skipped something. Go back. Now, I couldn't use my authority and say, well, I'm the dad, and I say we're skipping through. They were saying, no, the script, the book has the authority. Go back and read the whole thing. Follow the script. And this was a great way to calm children down and put them to sleep. But it was a terrible way to expand their horizons if it was always the same book, read always in the same way, and each of my children eventually had to go beyond that one single book and start hearing new things, going to school and reading new things. In order to reach their potential, they had to break out of that comfortable, same old script that would put them to sleep comfortably, and realize that there's something greater than the same old, same old. Well, Jesus does not come to Capernaum, and he does not come to Worcester to fit into our same old script. He comes to author a new script, a new story, and that is his authority over us, inviting us into a new day. A new story arrived in Capernaum when Jesus came. New stories arrive in churches like ours when Jesus comes and begins to author a new story, and people say, why are we stuck like machines in that same old story? Can we break out and experience something new? This is what happens when a free person like Jesus comes on stage. The contrast is disturbing. All of those people who are going according to the script start to wonder, what's going on? This isn't what we usually do. They look at someone like Jesus and say, now who's wrong, me or him? And if it's me, maybe I need to change my ways and fit into what he is doing. The question will nag people. Am I the one who's wrong? Do I have it incorrect? Am I living according to the wrong script? Is there another script available to me? And if so, is now the time to enter into it? And many people then wake up. And when people begin to wake up and live according to a new, fresh script authored by Jesus, synagogues in Capernaum and churches in Worcester come alive. But there are some people who lash out and say, we were fine just the way we were. In the story that Ellen read from Mark, there is one who stood up and lashed out and said, Jesus, if you come to destroy us, in other words, leave us alone. There will always be resistance in every congregation in Capernaum or Worcester when something new begins to happen. And Jesus goes on nevertheless. He is not daunted. He knows that, yes, people like the Grand Inquisitor would say would prefer predictability, but he knows better. He's created us for freedom, to author us into a new story, to live by faith instead of by certainty, to live not according to the script, but by the Spirit. The authority of Jesus comes when he starts to author a new story among us. We are set free from our mechanical ways, and suddenly we experience the freedom of full humanity in relationship to God. We live sort of creatively improvisational, living by the Spirit. This is not chaotic. People think if we don't go according to the script, there will be chaos. No, where the Spirit comes, things good begin to happen among people. There was a guy in a church I served, his name was Joe. And Joe was exemplary. I mean, good as gold, pure and simple. And I used to ask people, do you trust that Joe will always do the right thing? If you wanted him to hold your money for a couple weeks, would you trust him? Watch your dog for a week, would you trust him? Help you when you need help, would you trust him? And they would say, invariably, yes, I would trust Joe every single time. And I would say, why do you trust Joe? Is it because he carries a script in his pocket for every situation he enters into and he follows it, is predictable or reliable? Or is it maybe because he is a decent human being, Spirit-filled, led by the Holy Spirit, following Jesus, wherever Jesus may lead him? Not according to a script, but according to the Spirit. And they would say, he's got Spirit. There is something about Joe that you can count on. No, he doesn't go according to a script. He goes according to the Spirit. But whatever he does, it's always good. This is what I am talking about. To be led by the Spirit rather than the script is not something fearful. It brings out the best in us. We begin to trust each other and not just the script. We begin to trust what God can do among us and not what we've always done before. This is about living now according to the Spirit. My authority as I come here into Worcester is not according to some script. I would think and I would hope that it is according to the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, who is in me. And I improvise through the days, through my work and ministry, not according to the same old GPC script, because I haven't learned it yet. Maybe I should maybe never learn it. Maybe I should instead live by the Spirit and invite you to improvise with me. It may wrangle some people. It wrangled people in Capernaum when Jesus did it. But I am in good company with Jesus. And join me, and join Jesus, and go according to a new script. And come alive. And don't be a machine. Live according to the Spirit and not the script. Yes, we all want people to come to GPC. We would like more people to come here. But don't think that if people come here, they're going to simply fit into our script and do things the way we have always done it. Let Jesus lead us, and as people come in, we begin to author a new story with the authority of the Holy Spirit working among us, free from the pressure of the old script, and letting God lead us into new stories ahead with the authority of the Spirit, not with the authority of a script. This is what Jesus did in Capernaum, and Jesus can do it here in Worcester. He doesn't come to fit into our script. He draws us into his, where we live by the Spirit, and we're no longer machines. We come alive in Christ. Amen.
Turning back.
all the participants that helped put this worship service online, on here, whether online or in person at the church, helping out. You can actually financially support the church by donating on greenhillpeopleschurch.org, or you can mail your funds to 25 Francis Street in Worcester, 01606. Or if you're in a neighborhood, you can just drop them off in the mail slot on the 25 Francis Street entrance. Please remember, immediately following the 10 a.m. service, there will be our annual congregational meeting, which will be virtual. You can connect through Zoom or your telephone using all the information that you received in your packet. And I want to remind you to get those ballots in by February 10th. We're still looking for people to help us do greetings, prayers, announcements, and readings for the next few months. If you can volunteer or have the time, we do have scripts, okay, available if you want to do a greeting or a prayer reading or announcements. Just contact deacons at greenhillpeopleschurch.org. And also, if you'd like to take part in how to operate Zoom, okay, do the virtual coffee hour at the same time, please contact Carolina at carolina@greenhillpeopleschurch.org. You don't need any special skills. You can be trained. There's no problem with that. Have a good week.
I'm Kim Perret, Governing Board Clerk, here to invite you to communion. Whoever you are, wherever you are on your journey, Christ welcomes you to his table. Green Hill People's Church celebrates an open communion, meaning all are welcome to fully participate in this great feast of grace, love, and forgiveness. If you have not done so, I invite you now to gather some bread or crackers, juice, coffee, whatever you have on hand, that we might all share in this great feast together. And as you gather your elements, may I reflect on this morning's scripture reading during the virtual service. The first reading was from Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 15 to 20. Who is this prophet? Stephen used this verse to support his claim that Jesus Christ is God's son, the Messiah. The coming of Jesus Christ to earth was not an afterthought, but part of God's original plan. The second reading was from Mark chapter 1, verses 21 to 28. Because the temple in Jerusalem was too far for many Jews to travel to regularly for worship, many towns had synagogues, serving both as places of worship and as schools. Beginning in the days of Ezra, about 450 BC, a group of 10 Jewish families could start a synagogue. There, during the week, Jewish boys were taught the Old Testament law and Jewish religion. Girls could not attend. Each Saturday, the Sabbath, the Jewish men would gather to listen to a rabbi teach from the scriptures. Because there was no permanent rabbi or teacher, it was customary for the synagogue leader to ask visiting teachers to speak. This is why Jesus often spoke in the synagogue in the towns he visited. Jesus had recently moved to Capernaum from Nazareth. Capernaum was a thriving town with great wealth, as well as great sin and decadence. Because it was the headquarters for many Roman troops, pagan influences from all over the Roman Empire were pervasive. This was an ideal place for Jesus to challenge both Jews and non-Jews with the gospel of God's kingdom. The Jewish teachers often quoted from well-known rabbis to give their words more authority, but Jesus didn't have that need. Because Jesus is God, he knew exactly what the scriptures said and meant. He was the ultimate authority. And now, an invitation to communion. May the peace of the Lord be with you. We lift up our hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is always right to give God thanks and praise, for we remember that even on the night when he was betrayed, Jesus gathered with his disciples to share a meal. And at that table, during the meal, he took the bread, blessed it, gave thanks to God, then broke it open, saying words like these: "This is my body. Take and eat it, all of you. Do this in remembrance of me. Then, in a like manner, he took the cup, blessed it, gave thanks to God, and shared it with all who were there, saying words like these: This cup contains the blood of the new and everlasting covenant that flows in and through me. It is given and shed for the forgiveness of sins. Take, all of you, and drink in remembrance of me. Each time we share in this great feast of grace, love, and forgiveness, Christ becomes present in us, with us, and through us once more. Creator God, through the power of your Holy Spirit, bless these many diverse elements we have gathered around the places we find ourselves this day. May they be for us nourishment to strengthen our bodies, spirits, hearts, and souls. Transform them, gracious God, and transform us as you have transformed grain of the field and grape of the vine, that we too may be nourishment to feed your hurting, hopeful, hungry world. Amen. Let us join in and participate together in this great feast of love. Take, eat, drink, and let us remember who we are because of who we are as children of the living God of love. Gracious God, merciful Creator, we thank you for calling us out of our fear-filled lives, gathering us in and inviting us to fully share in this great feast of remembrance. Comfort, challenge, and guide us that we may truly bring healing and hope to your hurting world. Amen. And now, let us join in our closing song.
Thank you.
this week and live with a little bit of risk. Go off the script and follow Jesus. Live by the Spirit and find freedom from all that mechanical sameness. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.
Don't worry, Mother. It'll be all right. And don't worry, Sister. Say your prayers and sleep tight. And it'll be fine, lover of mine. It'll be just fine. And lend your voice. No longer lend your strength to that which you wish to be free from. Feel us with love and bravery, and we shall lead a life uncommon. I've heard your anguish. I've heard your hearts cry out. We are tired, we are weary, but we aren't worn out. Set down your chains till only faith remains. Set down your from. Fill us with love and bravery, and we shall lead a life uncommon. There are plenty of people who pray for peace, but if praying were enough, it would have come to be. Let your words enslave no one, and the heavens will hush themselves to hear our voice.